Good morning. We appreciate technology when it works. And we won't say what we do when it doesn't work. But I just wanted to share a couple of announcements this morning. Today, after church, we have Sunday school in the fellowship hall. And just want to make you aware of that class that's coming up. And Pastor Gary is going to be teaching out there this morning. And I was sharing a little bit about what I was preaching on in here. And he says, wow, that just kind of dovetails into what I'm going to be talking about in Sunday school. So that's awesome. This week, today, Pat, where are you at? There she is. Backpacks? Tomorrow. Backpacks are doing tomorrow. Okay. We have 300 backpacks that we're going to pass out to 10 different elementary schools. So that's, we're excited about being involved with that and making those available for the kids to get those at the beginning of school year. Also, this Wednesday night, we are continuing our series on spiritual warfare Bible study by Tony Evans. And the first 2 weeks have been great. And if you haven't been able to come, we want to encourage you to come. Even though you missed the first two, you can still pick up where that's at and go from there. But it's a powerful, powerful series, so it's great. So I just want to also take some time this morning. This session is going to be the breastplate of righteousness is what we're going to be talking about on Wednesday. So this is going to go for another 5 weeks. So it's going to be, it's a longer series. So it's been really, really good. I want to do something this morning for us to say hi to someone who hasn't been able to be here because of being housebound, and that's Yvonne. Yvonne has been in charge of our ladies' exercise class. We started this quite a few years ago, and she was instrumental in helping us get started, and she worked in the curves area and has taken that on. But as of recent months, she's not been able to be involved with that because she had diagnosis of cancer, and now she's homebound. So we talked to her this week, and we're going to ask for you to stand and turn around and look at that black camera right over the door, and right there, Vicky's pointing at it, and we want you to say hi to Yvonne and say we love you. We want to say hi, Yvonne, we love you and miss you. So, and then there we have a picture that's going to be up here on the screen. We went by with Kayla and Vicky, and I went by with Carly, and so she got to hold Carly. And she told me yesterday when I was visiting, she said, don't forget to bring that baby back. So, all right. Well, let's have a word of prayer and ask God's blessing on our time this morning. We appreciate you all being here. And those of you that are joining us and engaging online, we appreciate that as well. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to come to worship you in person as well as online. And we ask, God, that you would just meet us here in this place. We thank you, Father, for your strength. We thank you, Father, that you're able to do all things well. We ask this, that you would prepare our hearts as we come in prayer, as we come in anticipation of what you have. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Good morning. You ready to sing? Yeah. Stand if you can. Ready?
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk blessed be your name. Every blessing.
king of my heart. Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. He is my song.
Oh,
may be seated this morning. We have some requests that we need to pray for this morning. I got a text from someone this past Friday to remember a young man by the name of Tyler Brown, who was in a motorcycle accident. He is in ICU. He is waking up, but confused about where he's at. So just pray for Tyler Brown, that God would just minister. And a couple of weeks ago, we had David Trebek, who is a works with Chosen People and is a Jewish, helping Jewish pastor and working with Jewish people. And one of the things that he asked us, not just once, but a couple of different times while we were having lunch with him after the service, and then we, Joe and I, met with him on Saturday afternoon as well, and he just kept saying, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and pray for the Jewish people to come to find Jesus as their Messiah. So I just want to encourage us to do that as well. And we have a number of other requests. Pray for Karen Gorham's daughter, Kathy, who is in critical condition. I did get a text from her this morning saying she's on her way. Karen is on her way back to California, but to continue to pray for Kathy for healing from her heart attack, that God would just intervene. And then also continue to remember Yvonne in prayer as well. A number of other requests that are on our prayer request list this morning. So let's just bow our heads in prayer and ask God's help in these areas. And if you need prayer here this morning, I'm going to ask those that pray with people to come and to minister to you. As you need prayer, come on forward and we'd be glad to pray with you. Lily and Marvin and Gary and Cindy, would you come and just take some time as we pray before the Lord and ask God just to minister in these situations. So if you have a need for prayer, just want to encourage you to come to one of these people up here, and they'll be glad to pray with you this morning. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and we ask in faith, believing that you are able to do all things well. And Lord, we ask that you would just minister to these different needs that have been shared with us. We ask, God, that you would touch by your Spirit. We pray for Tyler, who's in intensive care. We ask, God, that you would just help him and that you'd help him to recover fully and completely from this accident. We pray for your hand of mercy and grace to be upon him. We pray, Father, for Karen's daughter, Kathy, who had a massive heart attack. We pray for healing there as well. And Father, we pray for a person that was a crime of domestic violence. And I pray, God, that you just minister to that person, that you would just be with them and help them and minister strength to them. We pray, God, that you would just put your arms of love around them. Father, we pray also for Yvonne, that you would just minister by your Spirit as she continues to be at home. We pray, God, that you would just bring help and health and healing to her body. We pray in the name of Jesus that you're able to do all things well. We thank you, Lord, that your will be done in that situation. Father, we pray for a number of other needs that are in our request list. We ask, God, that you would just touch by your Spirit. We pray for Glenn, that you would minister to him as he goes through some procedures. We ask, God, that you just minister by the power of your might. We pray for Javier dealing with arthritis. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to be his help and strength. Father, we pray for Carmelita, that you would just help her as she continues to recover. We thank you, Lord, that you would just give her strength. And Father, I just pray for my sister-in-law back in Wisconsin. I talked to my sister yesterday, and we ask, God, that you would just touch Shelley, that you would minister to her. We thank you, Lord, that you are able to do your work in and through that situation. Father, we pray that you would help Shelley to be able to wake up. We pray that you would just minister healing and health to her, we pray. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, O God, that you are able to be her strength. And we ask, God, that you would just be with her husband, Dave. my brother, that you would just be with him and help him and strengthen him and his family. We pray, God, that you would just move by your Spirit in a powerful way and all these different needs. We pray for Richard Staggs, who's in the hospital. We ask, God, that you would just continue to work healing in him. We pray, Father God, that you would just minister to all the teachers and the students that will be returning to school in Fresno Unified tomorrow. And we thank you, Lord, that you will continue to be with those students and teachers at in Central Unified that started this past week. And Lord, as we look forward to next Monday, the 22nd, as Clovis Unified begins, we pray for the teachers and students there as well. We thank you, Lord. We praise you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your strength. We ask, God, that you would just continue to move in a mighty way. And we ask this in the precious and holy name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. I do want to just give you some encouragement here. Answers to Prayer, I know that Pastor Tim shares a little bit about this before we pray, but it's interesting when you do certain things and you're struggling with things with spiritual warfare, the enemy doesn't like that. Well, I'm going to pick on Pat Cruz this morning, but she's laughing back there. But she got out of church last Sunday morning and her car wouldn't start. And we jump-started it, and it started, and it died. Jump-started it, she got in it to take off, and it would die. And so she finally said, I'm just going to call tow truck driver, and it was a bad battery. And she said, you know, in that first message in Wednesday night Bible study, was talking about being underneath God's umbrella. She said, there's times that I felt like I was out from underneath God's umbrella. Sometimes you feel like that, don't you? You know? And so her car's fixed now, right, Pat?
Yes.
It's fixed. It's running and everything. So she's praising God for that. And there was a Manny's friend got to move into a new home. Apparently something, they had to move out quickly, but this new home became available sooner than later, and they were able to move from one place to the other without having to store their stuff and put it away and then having to move it again. And then Ted and Erlinda. Ted has not been here because he's been moving, and he's moved into his new house. So Brian and I went by there yesterday to kind of help them get the water heater lit for them and get the stove got it going for them and everything. So Ted and Erlinda are in their new home to them. It's they're purchasing. This is their first purchase of a new home for them. It's new to them. It's an older home, but it's new to them and it's theirs. So we just praise God for that. And then for my son-in-law and my daughter and my newest granddaughter, got to move into their new home, and they're getting situated and settled as much as they can. So we're praising God for that. So some good things and some positive things as well. One thing that I do want to mention, and we'll be receiving an offering here just toward the end of the service today, but there is a in the bulletin talking about the American Bible Society that we're receiving an offering. If you want to give an offering toward Bibles, there's a matching grant that will be coming alongside of that. And some of you have already done that and responded to that. So that's going to be something for the in the offering coming up toward the end of this service this morning. So, well, this is interesting. This is. We remember Tyler Brown I just prayed for. I just got a text from his fiance's dad, okay? And this is what he says. He says he's awake. He's still somewhat confused, breathing on his own. His CAT scan is negative. Only broken bone is his shoulder blade and tailbone. Everything else is fine. They cut on his neck. They want to monitor since it could swell and cause his airway to close. So he's doing better, doing better. So praise God for that. So God is good. Amen. So praise God. God's good all the time. All right. So last week I started talking about money talks. a series on talking about money, and we talked about earning it. Instead of chasing it, we need to earn it. And it was kind of funny listening this morning. Joe was saying, talking about his kids when they were growing up, you know, they getting part-time jobs or whatever they could do to get a little bit of money. You know, dad, mom, not going to buy your own car. You're going to have to buy your own. You have to earn it yourself. You have to buy it yourself. So they had to earn it. So this morning, I want to talk a little bit about this area of saving it. So we have earn it, save it. Next week is spend it. Last week is give it. Okay? So this is week two. And savings is something that is not talked too much about in church. It's talked about, you know, retirement and all this kind of stuff and save it. But then they're also on the other side of the coin, they want you to spend it. And we're going to talk about that next week, so I don't want to get ahead of myself. But the interesting thing is that we talk about savings, we talk about other things, and there's some things that we talk about in regards to saving that people get overboard in that, and then it becomes what we call hoarding. And as Americans, we love our reality shows, don't we? Television shows, and there's a series that aired for 6 years on the A&E network called Hoarders. I never watched the program. I just caught glimpses of it. And it was people who had real-life struggles and received treatment for their compulsive hoarding disorder. And as each hoarder received help and treatment, the primary battle was parting with their belongings, getting rid of the things that they've been hoarding. And I can remember seeing one scene in one where there was just a path through the whole house, and there was newspapers stacked everywhere. And they just collected newspapers, whatever. So, and it's a radical behavior, you know, but we look at that, and many have a hoarding mentality when it comes to money. So how can we be set free from this mindset or this tendency? And that is precisely what we want to jump into today as we look at this area of saving it. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, Jesus taught his disciples, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, thank you for your word today. Lord, I thank you as we continue to look into other passages of Scripture and your word. We ask, God, that you would open our hearts and our minds to what you would have us to hear, and that we would be able to apply it in Christ's name. Amen. If you're not careful, money can easily replace God as your master. Someone once posted the question, which statement scares you more, there is no God or there is no money in your bank account? If you're honest with yourself, the statement raises your level of anxiety more. For many of us, running out of money is greater fear, so we chase after it and we cling to what we do have and we hoard our money. There's two different things that we look at. We talk about prosperity versus poverty. There are some who claim that saving isn't biblical. Jesus didn't save, so we shouldn't either, right? And Jesus told the parable of the rich young ruler in Matthew chapter 19, 16 through 30, and Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31, and Luke chapter 18, 18 through 30. And he said, in which he told the wealthy young man that came to Jesus asking what he needed to do to earn eternal life. And Jesus replied in Matthew 19:21, "If you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." And people often argue whether this was Jesus' response to just the one individual, that particular person, or is it a command for every Christian against saving money? After all, the disciples left their livelihoods behind to follow Jesus, and if we really believe in God, shouldn't we trust him for our daily bread like the Israelites did in the wilderness? And this belief system often is referred to as the poverty gospel. And on the other side of things, we have this idea of the prosperity gospel, preached in some churches today. And the prosperity gospel says that if you believe God and give to the XYZ ministry of the person that's preaching at the time, you'll become richer than you've ever imagined. And pretty soon you'll be driving a luxury car, living in a brand new mansion, and going on tropical vacations every other month. Not The reality of the gospel is a little different. Scripture is filled with examples of godly men and godly women who were poor, whether by choice or through circumstance, such as the person Ruth in the Old Testament, the widow who gave her the widow who gave two coins, and Jesus told the story. The story of the rich man and Lazarus in the New Testament. Perhaps the most famous story of someone choosing a life of poverty for the sake of the gospel is Jesus himself, God becoming man to come and live on earth as one of us. Can you imagine Jesus, the Son of God, coming from glory into this place called earth and all the things that he had to deal with and the limitations and such that he was dealing with in the human form? But Scripture also shows us many examples of God-fearing individuals who are wealthy and prosperous as well. Abraham, Joseph, King David, King Solomon. You can read about all those in the Bible. Matthew and Lydia, just to name a few, are those people that talk about the things that they had and how God had blessed them. Then there were people like Job and the Apostle Paul who experienced both poverty and wealth at different points in their lives. And we all talk about, and we have read the book of Job. Some of us have read the book of Job and all the things and all the trials that he went through and all those things that he lost, and then he gained it all back. Then we see Paul and what he did and how God used him in a powerful way as well. So the question then becomes not much how much money you should have, but how to honor God with the money that you do have. Let me say that again. It's not how much money you should have, but how to honor God with the money you do have. There is that saving versus hoarding. The key verse in every area of your finances is putting God first. Putting God first. When you do, watch how he provides. The Israelites spent 40 years in the wilderness totally dependent on God. Totally dependent on God and all the things that they were going through. And he provided manna each morning. A white flaky substance like bread. And manna literally means what is it in Hebrew. And each morning the Israelites were told to gather what they needed for that one day. And this rule was to protect them from hoarding. If they gathered more than they needed, the manna became infested with maggots and became spoiled. And there was one exception, and that was the day before the Sabbath day. They were to gather double the amount. But can you imagine with me those Israelites that would go out and gather more than they needed, and the next day they found maggots, and then they come to the Sabbath, the day before the Sabbath day, and they were instructed to gather more than that so that they wouldn't have to go out and gather anything on the Sabbath day. And you read about it in the Old Testament where some of them gathered that and kind of looked at the next day on the Sabbath day and they found out, oh, there's no maggots. It's there. It's good. And then there were some that would still go out on the Sabbath day looking for the manna and it was gone. It was not there. And God would say to them, don't you trust me? God was teaching them to trust. Where in your own life is God teaching you to trust him? This isn't a poverty gospel, nor is it a prosperity gospel. Instead, saving is all about a heart that's right before God. A heart that trusts him enough to say, I'm not going to hoard money or things because God alone is my portion. In Luke chapter 12, verse 21, it says, so he that layeth up treasure for himself is not rich toward God. And I was reading and doing some studying this week. It says, the anxiety of a covetous man is not what good he may do with his wealth, but where he may hoard it and keep it secure from doing any good. Let me say that again. The anxiety of a covetous man is not what good he may do with his wealth, but where he may hoard it and keep it secure from doing any good. So that's hoarding. Keeping it to yourself where it's not doing anyone any good. And this is not to say that we shouldn't save. Through Joseph, we see that God instructed the Egyptians to save during the 7 years of plenty to prepare for the 7 years of famine that follow. Pharaoh trusted Joseph, and Joseph kept all of Egypt and ultimately his own family and the Israelite people from starving to death. And Joseph trusted God even to save when God said to save. The difference between Joseph and the Israelites trying to hoard manna was the posture of their hearts. When God said save, Joseph saved. When God told the Israelites not to hoard, they had to trust and only gather enough for that day ahead. God will lead and guide you if you let him. And that applies as much to money as it does in every other area of your life. So let God be your provider. If you need a reminder, look at a dollar bill. Find those words that say, "In God we trust." There's a visible reminder of God's provision on the very wealth in your wallet, in your purse. As the Israelites prepared to enter the promised land, Moses reminded them of how God provided manna in the wilderness, how God kept even the clothes from wearing out. Moses cautioned them, "God gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors have never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, 'My power and your strength and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me.' But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth." Deuteronomy 8:16 through 18. God has given us the opportunity to do that, to produce wealth, yes. Who gave you the wealth that you have? God. Even if you didn't inherit a dime from your family and worked hard to build wealth up for yourself, God gave you the strength of your hands and the creativity of your mind. God is the one who gave you the very ability to build the wealth that you have, whether it's that's a lot or a little. God gave, we need to say, "God, we thank you for what you have given us. We thank you for the blessings that you have blessed us with." One thing I remember growing up on the farm was the ability to store the crops to feed the animals through the winter. And we trusted God to provide the rain that was needed to grow the crops and the sun to help as well. And we grew hay and we grew corn and oats and we harvested it during the summertime. And this is during this month is oat season. We harvested the oats and usually was, it is the hottest and the most stickiest month, I think, of the year in the Midwest. And I hated it because whenever you were harvesting grain, all that dust would just kind of go stick to your body and just and make you itch. But the thing is that we harvested the oats and we were baling hay and the corn wasn't ready to chop yet or what, it doesn't come in until October. And September is when we chop corn silage and October is when we pick the corn for the corn crib and all this kind of stuff. And things have not really changed. They've changed a little bit over the years, but the seasons always are the same. You're not going to plant corn in November and expect to harvest it in April, okay, in Wisconsin. I'm just saying, it's not going to happen. Just saying. The seasons are the same. But saving was the key because we didn't always use all of our oats in the oat bin for feeding the cattle or feeding and grinding it and using it for feed. My dad would save out a certain number of bushels of oats and he would take it the following spring to the fanning mill, which they would treat it. They would fan out all the weed seeds and then they would treat it with an insecticide and then we would take it and plant that oats. And that oats was planted the year, that oats was something that we harvested the year before in August. So we didn't feed it all to the cattle. We kept some of it back. And that's part of that savings process. We've heard the term depression babies. I'm not one of them, but I act like one, okay? However you define that is different, but for me, I wasn't a depression baby, but my parents were, and they saved everything because their motto was, and some of you can finish this, "You never know when you might need it." And the other one was, "About the time that you throw it away, that's when you need it." Okay, so there you go. I don't need to go any further with that because all of you know my little cliches there. There we go. Saving, not hoarding, is important. We trust God and we can trust him in all areas of our lives. Last week when I was preaching about earning it, I was preaching to myself. So, and this week I'm doing the same thing. But saving requires wisdom. Saving requires understanding and knowing what is best for you. I have a garage full of stuff. And you can talk to Vicki and she's shaking her head yes. And as we have been purging and cleaning in different areas for family, it has caused Vicki and I to work on what is truly worth keeping or giving away in our own lives so that our kids won't have to go through it. And Kayla and Caitlin are back there. My two youngest are back there saying, yeah, please, we don't want to have to go through all your stuff. Savings was not important when I was growing up. Savings were not important to me when I was growing up. I opened a savings account at the local bank and put some money in the account to open it. And when I sold a calf or a steer, I would put the money in the bank. And when I opened a checking account, then came the issue of making sure there was enough money in the checking account, writing a check. Today, one has to make sure that there's money in their account before one uses their debit card, because it seemingly instantaneously, when the money is spent, is gone out of your account. Remember the days when you could write a check and expect it to take a few days to get to the bank and you had some time to get there to put the money in? No, them days are gone, because they'll take that account number right off the check and ping, it's gone. So, saving is hard. Saving is hard to do, but when you save with God in mind, it helps one focus on what is important in your life. God will bless the increase as we put God first. Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Heaven, not earth, is our home. Heaven, not earth, is our home. How much is enough? Money says there's never enough. You need to be happy. You need more so that you can sleep easy. The thing is, more doesn't equate happiness or enjoyment. When God is part of a person's life, it makes a difference. Using the wisdom of God to know the right direction we should be going with our money. God, on the other hand, says, "Come to me, all who are weary, and you will find rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul." Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Trust me to provide. God is telling us, trust me. Trust me. I am your source. I am your source of joy. I am your source of contentment. Like Paul, we must learn to be content in both seasons of plenty and seasons of want. Philippians 4, 11 through 13. Ultimately, money doesn't come with us into eternity, does it? What is the phrase? You can't take it with you. You will eventually have to leave it to someone who comes after you. And at that point, you have no control over what they do with it. Even while we're alive, money can be here one day and gone the next. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus warns against trying to store up riches here on earth. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. Matthew 6, 19 through 20. Few earthly possessions are long-lasting, and none are eternal. Nothing on this earth is eternal except your soul. Your soul. It's what you do with your money that counts. So why save? James said in James 5, 1 through 3, it says, "Now listen, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming on you. Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Your corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days." You've hoarded it. You've kept it so that there is no good to come of it for anyone else. James isn't saying that saving is a terrible thing to do, but when we hoard money simply for ourselves, it will not last. Saving has to be done with a purpose in mind, avoiding any unnecessary expenses that are wasteful. In other words, purchase what you need, but don't be extravagant. Keep it basic. It all comes down to a living of a life of simplicity by deciding what we require and what we will be doing to go, what we are willing to go without. In saving and planning for the future, we hold this tension, knowing heaven, not earth, is our home. We don't know the number of days that we have, and even our best laid plans can come to ruin, but the one thing that we do know, the one thing that is certain, is that Jesus is Lord. Amen? That Jesus is Lord, and when we accept him as our Lord and Savior, everything changes. God's perfect love casts out fear. God's peace that surpasses all understanding washes away anxious thoughts. And God will keep the person in perfect peace whose mind is fixed on him because that person trusts in God. So where is your hope today? Where is your peace? Where is your trust? I was thinking that a year ago today, Vicki was going to, it was a Monday, the 14th last year was on a Monday. She was going down to the Kaiser Hospital to get checked for COVID, and she came back positive with COVID. And then we went to the hospital emergency later on in that week. And then the following Sunday, she was taken by ambulance to the hospital and spent 16 days there. So that is in the back of my mind. And I look at this message here, and it says, all the money in the world and all the savings in the world didn't mean a thing. What meant so much to me was my wife and her getting healed. So where is your hope today? Where is your peace? Where is your trust? My trust and my hope is in Jesus. Freedom comes in surrendering all that we have and all that we are to the Lord. Surrender is the single most powerful tool to achieving financial freedom. A financial advisor may promise freedom if you allow him or her to invest your money, but even the savviest investor can't guarantee peace of mind. Only God can do that. Amen? Only God can do that. Ultimately, saving and surrendering everything that you have to God is a powerful act to trust in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Obedience is the currency of faith. It's faith in action. It's following through and trusting and a loving trust and saying, okay, Lord, I may not understand this totally and fully, but I know that you are good, so I trust you anyway. Whatever the Lord is calling you to do, we invite you to do it today. There are overarching biblical principles that we can look at for finance and stewardship, but God may have a specific word for you today. And what is God calling you to do with all that you have as you surrender it to him? God is faithful and God is true. As you step out in obedience and trust, watch what the Lord can do and will do through you in your life. So as we talk about saving it, we first have to surrender it, our lives to him. Saving it, to surrender it. But there's more to that than that. There's more to this. We have to surrender our life to him so that he may direct our paths. We have to surrender our life to him so that he can tell us which direction to go and how do we need to do this or how do we need to do that. So, well, Pastor, I'm not really ready to do that because I have control of what I have. Do you? Do you? What better control to have than God? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you for your goodness. And Lord, we just pray that you would just minister by your Spirit and speak to our hearts today and help us to understand that we need to surrender, first and foremost, we need to surrender our lives to you. And as we surrender our lives to you, that we entrust to you those areas of our life. Lord, that we would earn it, yes. That we would save it, yes. And Lord, you will direct us on how we need to do that. And it's not that we are hoarding it, but Lord, it's that we are saving it so that we would be able to maybe be a blessing to other people, to be a blessing to those that are in need. We thank you, Lord. We praise you that you are able to touch our lives and speak to our lives. And Father, I thank you. And God, I ask that you would speak to our hearts today. And maybe there's someone that's listening that may not know who Jesus is or is kind of curious. And we need to just say, Lord, I come before you and I ask and I surrender my life to you. And I ask that you'd come into my life. And I ask that you forgive me of my sins and cleanse me of all my unrighteousness. And we ask, God, that you would just speak to our hearts today. And that we would turn from the things that we were doing that are wrong or that are not according to you, Lord, that we would turn our lives toward you and say, Lord, I put my life in your hands. What is the direction that I need to go? Lord, I surrender those things to you. Can we just do as an act of surrender, just, you know, hold out your hands, palms up. Say, Lord, here I am. Lord, I surrender my life to you. Lord, I ask that you would just lead me and guide me in the things that I need to be doing. Lord, I ask that you would help me in earning it. I ask that you would help me in saving it. And Lord, as we continue in this series, that you'll guide us and help us in spending and giving it. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. But Lord, we surrender our lives to you. Lord, speak to our hearts and our lives today. Lead us and guide us and direct us into all truth. Lead us into your word. Lead us into the things that we need to be doing, and that we would be obedient to your, that we would be obedient to your call, that we would be obedient to your word. And we thank you, Lord, and we praise you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The interesting thing is that as I was studying for this morning, I got woke up at 5:30 this morning. I usually get up at 5:30, and the Lord started giving me some other words that you're not only talking about saving money, but you're talking about people that need to be saved as well. Yeah, and a person needs to be saved so that their money can be saved. You follow me? If you say, Lord, save me, help me, turn my life over to you, Lord, I thank you that you've given these resources to me to be able to share those with others so that you would help me, and I trust you that you'll take care of me as well. But we ask God to help us in all of those areas. So we're going to ask the ushers to come at this time, and then we're going to sing one last song as we wrap this up this morning. We appreciate your continued faithfulness to the work and the ministry here at Clovis First, and we appreciate what God is doing and how God is continuing to minister in our midst. And we still are giving out groceries. We're giving out backpacks this week. So a number of different things that we're wanting to be involved in with this this coming fall as well. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity we have to give. We pray that you would bless the tithe and the offering this morning. We thank you as we receive it, and that you would bless each and every one as they give. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Lord of all. Father, we thank you and we praise you. Lord, we thank you that you would lead us and guide us in this area of saving. We ask, God, that you would help us as we continue to surrender our lives to you to be obedient to your call. We ask that you go with us now. We pray for the Sunday school hour at this time, that you would just bless Pastor Gary as he would share with the Sunday school class. We ask, God, that you would bless this week as we get the backpacks ready to go, and that we would be able to have the opportunity of blessing many, many children, but also families as well. Go with us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless.